Somewhere in the distance, I heard the hammer ring as they drove the nail in his hands and in his feet. As the crowd gathered round, sing away with him. Jesus knew down in his heart that he would live again. He had risen. He has risen. That old tomb is empty now. All that remains is grave clothes and blood stains. That old tomb is empty now. As they laid him in the tomb, soldiers camped around. But God was making plans to send his angels down. They heard a sound, but when the Spirit spoke to him, he got up and walked around. He had risen. He had risen. That old tomb is empty now. That old tomb is empty now. That old tomb. That old tomb is empty now. Thank you. I've always been a man of few words. I don't talk good, I mumble bad, but still my prayers are heard. And they availeth much, so Scripture says, as they travel to the throne. Sometimes silence falls and fills the air when I'm all alone. And when I don't know how to pray, I just praise. When life gets hard, the words won't come, I don't know what to say. So I'll just bow my head and raise my hands, Lord, hallowed be thy name. And when I don't know how to pray, I just praise. And my praying time is filled with requests. I offer little, but want so much. Lord, you know what is best. But in the middle of the quiet times, in the storms of life, intercession occurs for me. And so thy kingdom come, thy will be done, from here to eternity. When I don't know how to pray, I just praise. Life gets hard, the words won't come, I don't know what to say. So I'll just bow my head and raise my hands, Lord, hallowed be thy name. When I don't know how to pray, I just praise. And I know the sun stood still when Joshua prayed, and by Elijah's prayer the fire fell down and your greatness was displayed. I don't have those words to pray right now. You know my heart, you know my mind, I trust you to work it out. I know my thoughts ain't yours and your ways ain't mine, I prove that every day. I'll just do my best to praise your name when I don't know how to pray.
Thank you. stillness of a tomb. But it's beyond all comprehension how life turns into art. When he painted me with Calvary's blood, I became a work of art. I'm not picture perfect, just ordinary clay. And I still feel the master's brush on my life from day to day. On display, and on a hill of condemnation is where my picture starts. When he painted me with Calvary's blood, I became a work of art. Oh, 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 I'm not picture perfect, just ordinary clay. And I still feel the master's brush on my life from day to day.
If your heart's not God pure and true. Oh, sinner, hear me when I say, fall down upon your knees and pray. I'd rather be in a deep, dark grave than to know that my poor soul was saved. World in a house of gold, and deny my God and lose my soul, and deny my God and lose my soul.
Moses at the burning bush, burning bush, burning bush. God spoke to Moses at the burning bush, and I am the Lord thy God. So take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy ground, holy ground, holy ground. Take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy. Smite that rock, smite that rock, smite that rock. Go yonder, Moses, smite that rock, for I am the Lord thy God. So take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy ground, holy ground, holy ground. Take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy ground. Salvation work, salvation work, salvation work. Stand still, Moses, see salvation work, for I am the Lord thy God. So take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy ground, holy ground, holy ground. Take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy ground.
Life's greatest trials I must face. My ship is tossed. Seems all will be lost when the God of all comfort speaks peace to my soul. When the God of all comfort speaks peace to my soul. Rough seas are calm, the winds cease to blow. No matter how dark may be the night, everything will be alright when the God of comfort speaks peace to my soul. When a broken heart leaves me hurting inside, like rain my tears fall through the night, His voice I hear. There's no reason to fear when the God of all peace to my soul. When the God of all comfort speaks peace to my soul. rough seas are calm, the winds cease to blow. No matter how dark may be the night, everything will be all right when the God of all comfort speaks peace to my soul. When the
got a few announcements tonight. Church going as usual. Same. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. We want everyone to know that we have not forgotten our seniors. The coronavirus has changed a lot of things going on this year. So we haven't forgotten them. We're planning to service for them Sunday, June the 28th. The difference this year because of social distance, okay, is that we won't be having a refreshment following service. Tables will be set up in the foyer, graduation pictures, and you can leave gifts or cards that you like to get to them on the table provided. If you have someone graduating as part of our church family, or someone in your family that you'd like to be a part of the service, please get their names to us as soon as possible, to Jackie or Allison. Also, we'll need 15 to 20 pictures emailed to us no later than June the 14th. If possible, we would like to have all the names of the ones participating by May the 31st. Deadline, May the 31st for names. Actual service will be the 28th of June. Please remember our seniors in prayer this week. Friday night, 22nd, would have been their graduation night. And at this point, they have already missed out on so many things. Please continue to remember Darby Rao. She was to have a C-section and extreme pain with a tomorrow. Can't remember her. For everything goes well. Things did go well for prayer was asked for Robert Thomas and his wife. They have a baby girl. Oh, everybody's doing good. Hazel Prater had her kidney stones crushed. She's doing good. Thank the Lord. Be no vacation Bible school this year because of the coronavirus. No unity service, May the 31st, because of the same pandemic is going on. That's a few of the things going on. We have anybody to add to our prayer list at this time, or take off of our prayer list this time?
Put Carlos 3. Carlos 3.
Carlos 3. Eddie? Anybody else? Quaker on Hospital. Carlos Thrift had a wreck in Quaker on Hospital. Anybody else? Who is? Sam. Sam's in the hospital now.
Seth.
Seth. Seth. Okay. Sorry. Seth. who was having surgery?
Joy Evans.
Okay, gotcha. Joy's been having a time, but she's gonna have some more surgery May 29th. We have had her on our prayer list, but if she's not, add her back to y'all's prayer list, please. And Seth Prescott, having kidney issues we know about. She's having a time. Anybody else? Davis and Waycross Hospital. So, don't know any details, but Carl Griffin saw where he'd passed away. Carl D. Griffin, I believe the way it was listed. Add him to your bereaved list. Yeah, somewhere in that area, Slaughterville, Hoboken. I don't know. I just know he's in that area. What else? Unspoken? You tell your member the ones that are out for coronavirus doing, still be safe, but still trust in the Lord to watch over. Jack, how about lifting these up for a few of the please? Dear and Brother Robert, here where they need to be in the house of the Lord, just love on them while they're there. Keep lifting them up for their Lord. Put them in the
Encourage all of you that have been bought by the shed blood of Jesus Christ to stand to your feet, and let's rejoice. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am.
Songs in the night. Redeemed,
truly redeemed are glad to say so and tell the world that they're Christians. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'm not ashamed his name to bear. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'll take him with me anywhere. I'll tell
shoes off if your feet don't stink. If they do, then use social distancing and get way over there. Hey, turn in your Bibles with me to Numbers 32. Numbers 32. We was in Numbers here a while back, and I forgot to tell Brother Pete up there, and I was trying to signal him to what to do, and I was going, Numbers? No one was expecting it, but anyway. Have you ever heard of a passage of Scripture and, you know, you hear them, maybe you even use them sometimes and don't know where they're at in the Word of God? We got one tonight. You ever heard the phrase, be sure your sins will find you out? We're there tonight. Some people have some of the craziest thoughts, I think, sometimes why they would even ask some things that they ask. And we're going to see that tonight in the Word of God. Pretty good many scriptures here, but I'm going to read them several at a time. So just bear with me there in verse 1. Now, the children of Israel's come out of Egypt, and they're wandering in the wilderness. And at this point, Caleb and Joshua and more spies has went into spy in the land of Canaan, and they've come back. If we'd have went with the majority at this time, they would have never went in. But they went with what God had told Moses, and what Caleb and Joshua had said. Now, having said that, let's look in verse 1. Now, the children of Reuben, there's some hard names right here, and I'm going to try to pronounce them. And the children of Gad had very great multitude of cattle. And when they saw the land of Jazer, which was on the east side of Jordan now, and you know where the promised land was, don't you? It was on the other side. So they saw this this grasslands, as I would appear to see it, and plenty of water here, and they had a bunch of cows. It said, when they saw the land of Jazer and the land of Gilead, that they behold, the place was a place for cattle. It says, the children of Gad and the children of Reuben came and spake unto Moses and to Eleazar the priest, and unto the prince of the congregation, saying, Ataroth, and Dibon, and Jazer, and Nimrah, and Heshbon, and Elali, and Shebam, and Nebo, and Beon. I deserve a hand of applause. No, I'm just kidding. I practiced them, but I still didn't get them all right. But anyway. Even the country which the Lord had smote before the congregation of Israel is a land for cattle, and thy servants have cattle. He says, wherefore, said they, if we found grace in thy sight, let this land be given unto thy servants for possession, and bring us not over Jordan. Now here's the thing. Where's the promised land? Over Jordan. So they're asking why, you know, 40 years of waiting, hundreds of years in Egypt waiting, here in the wilderness waiting, hear what and heard what the spies had to say, and all these things. And it's just amazing what some people can come up with. But they saw that the plains were well grassed and it was made for cattle. And so they went to the proper place. They went to the priest. They went to Moses. And they laid this petition out that they would not go over. Have you ever heard anybody say it in such a way that they're actually going to help you by doing this? And that's kind of what we see here. So they made this request. So it was kind of unseemly. Why wouldn't you want to go to the promised land, the land which floweth with milk and honey? There's plenty of room there. If it's flowing with milk and honey, which is means it's lavish, it's rich, it's fruitful, why wouldn't you want to go? But they saw this. Well, it might have been the best land they'd ever saw before, but here it is, but it's not in the promised land. Verse 6 says, and Moses said unto the children of Gad and the children of Reuben, he says, shall your brethren go to war, and shall you sit here? Now, here's the question. What he's getting at, he says, now, God has promised us this land. And he's promised us victory in there. But we still got to fight. We still got to fight. Now, we're up to this point, and you're making plans not to go with us. Is it right that your brethren, whom y'all have friends, and we've all been together all this time, it's going to be kind of a tough situation, are you really going to sit back here knowing that from what Joshua and Caleb had said, that even some of them said there was giants in the land and there was this and there was that, you going to really let your brethren go over, not their blood brothers, so to speak, but the brethren go over there while you sit here? In verse 7 it says, and wherefore discover ye the heart of the children of Israel from going over into the land which the Lord hath given them. And thus did your fathers when I sent them from Kadesh Barnea to see the land. Here's what's fixing to happen. Moses has said these things to them and says, listen, we've come this far and we all stuck together and we all sinned together and we all been victorious together. We've been fed together. God's blessed us together. And now you're not wanting to go over into the land of Canaan. But have you ever noticed that sometimes a certain type of people, I'll put it that way, certain type of people or races of people, and I don't mean that in a bad way, just bear with me, as far as the Middle East people, I'll bring that in, maybe calm that down just a minute, but you know, I'm not racist, but that they tend to be, because some of them are out of the seed of Manasseh, and some of them are out of Ishmael, and some of them's out of that kind of group, and they go basically the way their fathers did. And this was the statement that he made back to them. He says, you know what happened when we sent your fathers over into spy on the land of Canaan. They're the one that come back and says, we can't do it. We're not going to do it. But Caleb and Joshua said they would. In verse 9 it says, and when they went up into the valley of Eshcol and saw the land, they discovered the heart of the children of Israel that they should not go into the land which the Lord had given them. Now, if somebody gives you something, are you going to go get it? You know, unless it comes with a bill. If it don't come with a bill, we go get it. Anything free. I mean, I'm all about that free stuff. And said, the Lord's given to you, but your father said that the Lord may be giving it to us, but it's not worth the fight. It's not worth it. We don't stand a chance. And showed a lack of faith in the leadership of Moses and Joshua and all the many ones there that was leading the way. And the Bible says in verse 10, And the Lord's anger was kindled the same time, and he swears, saying, surely none of the men that came up out of Egypt for 20 years old and upward shall see the land which I swear unto Abraham, unto Isaac, unto Jacob, because they have not wholly followed me. It was a reminder. When Reuben and Gad had asked about these situation, he's just reminding them what their fathers had done, and said it kindled the anger. It kindled a fire of anger in God, and in God made us not allowed us to go in there from 20 years up, from out of Egypt and on up. We not to even see the land of Canaan. Is that a chance you would like? Are you willing to risk making God angry that you would not possess that he's give you? It's the same thing when Jesus Christ died for us, that he made a way for us to go to heaven. And don't you think the God's anger is going to be kindled like a wildfire for those who do not accept him or trust in him or have faith in him and doubt him? He's made a land for us that flows better than milk and honey. It's for eternity. And when he comes to destroy the earth and all like that, his anger will be kindled. It's much said here. So an example is all over the Word of God, but here we see that. In verse 12, he says, save or except Caleb, the son of... If anybody want to jump on that one, I really missed that. Jephunneh. That was pretty close to what I thought. The Kenzite and Joshua, the son of Nun, for they have wholly followed the Lord. Here's the two examples. A whole bunch of them said no. Two said yes. They're going to get to enter into the land of Canaan, and them's not. Does that kind of ring a bell maybe to Wednesday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night's message? Straight, narrow is the way, and few there be that find it. Well, only two said we can, and a dozen said no. No, we can't do it. So because of their decisions, they were not wholly follow the God wholeheartedly, then therefore the penalty is they're going to wander in the wilderness till they die. And the Lord's anger was kindled against Israel and made them wander in the wilderness 40 years until all the generations that had done evil in the sight of the Lord was consumed. You know, it's like a slow death. Well, what are we waiting on, Moses? Till y'all to die. The Lord says you won't get there, so as soon as y'all die out, then the rest of them folks is going to go in. Ain't that sad? Would somebody please plainly tell us? Well, the sad thing is, preachers are preaching that today, and people are saying that today, you must be born again, or you shall surely die. You shall die. You'll die and go to a place called hell. Verse 14, it says, "Behold, ye are risen up in your father's stead, an increase of sinful man, to the augment yet the fierce anger of the Lord toward Israel." What is he saying? He says, y'all doing exactly what your fathers did. To even mention what you mentioned to me, you're doing exactly. The apple don't fall far from the tree, does it? Sins can go through generations. That's according to the Word of God. And they just have a tendency to do that. Raise your kids in the way they should go. When they get old, they won't depart from it. If you don't raise them in the way they should go, when they get old, they're going to depart from you and literally destroy your family. Here's what happens. They're going to buck the system and not just go on and keep their mouth shut. Don't they think for a moment there that the grass is better? Here's the scenario, and it comes again. God is a wonderful and understanding God. Moses and the priest here get insight from God in a warning shot to these people. He says, "For if ye turn away from after him, he will yet again leave them in the wilderness, and ye shall destroy all the people." And they came near unto him and said, "We will build sheepfolds for our cattle and cities for our little ones. But we will ourselves go, and we will go ready, armed before the children of Israel until we have brought them into their place, and our little ones shall dwell in the fenced cities because of the inhabitants of the land. We will not turn unto our houses until the children of Israel have inherited every man his inheritance." Now, that's a bold statement. Let me just throw this scripture at you. It's better to make a vow, never to make a vow, than to make a vow and to break a vow. So the consequences of not honoring what you say you'll do. You know, when you become born again, you telling Jesus that he's your Savior, he's your Lord, he is your all in all, he is everything to you, and he expects you to live and act that way. So if you're not doing that, and you are a Christian, you have been saved and washed in the blood of the Lamb, then if you're not walking in the way, then you're doing what these guys are being explained if what happens to them. The ultimate thing here, it says, you will continue to wander in the wilderness. Not only that, it was not good for the morale of the Israelite people that they was going to separate, and that body of water separate them. You might as well say it might as well have been 100 miles wide, because you're either in the land of Canaan or you're not. And they was not. Let me put it this way. You're either in the promised land or you're not. You're either on your way to heaven or you're not. You know, you're going to go to heaven or you're not. You'll go to hell. So when you see what Moses is trying to tell them, trying to deter them to change their mind, it's just kind of crazy that they still insist. And they're going, "I'll tell you what we'll do. If you'll give us time over here, we'll build some houses. We'll build a fenced city. We'll build sheepfolds. In other words, we'll put up fences. We'll make corrals. We'll do things like that. And I'll tell you, we're going to leave the women and children behind." Is that smart? I mean, really, what could happen while they were away? What will happen for the refugees that they run into and run back across there, and they go, "Hey, there's their women and children. Have mercy." You know, if they leave some back to protect them, then therefore they're not going to be actually sending all the ones that could fight. So they're not all in. They just had a better idea than what God did. Listen on. It's in verse 18, "We will not return unto our houses until the children of Israel have inherited every man his inheritance, for we will not inherit with them." Man, is that not sad? Is that almost saying, you know, we like it better over here. We really don't want what God had for us. We really don't want what God has for us. we will not inherit with them. They're going to inherit on the other side. They laying claim to that. They done won the battle up to that point. I mean, crossing over Jordan. What is some of the phrases spoke about people who's gone on to be with the Lord? They've crossed Chile Jordan. They've done this. They've done that. You know, and here, you know, oh, happy day is on the other side. We're just waiting for the water to go back and Jesus to call us and we gone. I don't know why in the world anybody want to stay back here. But anyway, we will not return to our houses. I've read that. In verse 19, he says, for we will not inherit with them on the yonder side of Jordan or forward. So we won't go over Jordan and we won't go beyond where they are to inherit anything because our inheritance is fallen to us on this side, Jordan eastward. My. Can you almost make it into heaven? Can you almost be saved? No. You can't almost. Almost, the Bible says, almost but lost. Almost. You remember what Agrippa said to Paul? He says, Paul, thou hast almost persuaded me to be a Christian. That means he didn't. Almost is nothing. Closeness only counts in horseshoes. And according to who you're playing with, who's making the rules, whether even that counts or not. But some people are willing to risk changing God's way to their own way. Now here, verse 20, listen very closely. And Moses said unto them, he says, if ye will do this thing. Now he done told them, he says, your family's had a bad habit of not doing what they said they'll do. They got sent over there with the leadership of God. They all come back healthy. They saw a land which flowed with milk and honey, but they were scared to death that God wasn't going to support them when they went over there. And now you wandered around for 40 years in the wilderness until they all died off. Are you willing to do the same thing? Are you willing to kill the morale of all the children of Israel that part of us is going to stay back? He says, Moses said to them, he says, if you will do this thing, if you will go armed before the Lord to war, and will go all of you armed over Jordan before the Lord until he driveth out his enemies from before him, and the land be subdued before the Lord, then afterward ye shall return and be guiltless. In other words, you will be free of blame, he says, before the Lord and before Israel. And this land shall be your possession before the Lord. They wanted something outside of what God was going to give them. But the famous statement that we've heard is spoken by Moses here. It was a warning shot. It was another warning. Unless you want something to happen that has already happened again, you might could reconsider what you're doing here. Verse 23, and here it is. He says, but if you will not do so. He said, now if you will do everything you said, it's going to be okay. If you will. You notice that word always pops up, if. You know, I think I'd have to have a little more confidence in something and say, I will. They said they will, and Moses says, but if you don't. I know people don't change their minds, do they? Why, heavens, no. No one changes their minds. He says, but if you will not do so, behold, ye have sinned against the Lord. You hadn't sinned against your brethren. You hadn't sinned against me. You have sinned against the Lord. Now that gets more personal. If you sin against me, that's one thing. But if you sin against God, you stand to be in trouble. It's kind of like when you read the back of Revelations when it talks about if someone changes some of this stuff in here, in God's Word, and they change that, they in danger of the chastisement and the judgment and the damnation of God. That's why I'm not going to touch it. I take it for its word. I believe what it says it'll do. And I fear God that he would do something like that. No, I ain't perfect, but I got sense enough to stay away from that. He says, if you do it, if you fail to do this, you'll sin against God. And notice what it says. He says, and be sure your sins will find you out. Why did he say that? Because sometimes people think because people of the church or people of Christians don't see you do something, that don't mean God don't see it. You could hide it from Moses. You can hide it from everybody else. You can hide it from Joshua. You can hide it from everyone else. But your sins will find you out. And how will that happen? All of a sudden, I don't know, maybe somebody gets sick. Maybe there's a pandemic shows up somewhere. Maybe your sins will find you out. How do you find them out? I'll tell you what'll make a fella look up if he's laying on the flat of his back. He looks up then. He has no choice. That's the alternative to not doing what God will have you to do and taking a risk. Could you imagine if they lived over there 100 years and you go, you know what, this is pretty good. We're going to quit doing that stuff they do over on the other side. You know, or we leave half of our people back and we're not going to help them completely. I told them I was going to send. You know what he said? He's going to build some houses. He's going to build some sheepfolds. He's going to do all that and just leave the women and children there. But when Moses spoke back to him, he says, that all of you would come and help. All of you would stay till our inheritance is intact fully. Oh, yeah. And his warning is, listen, if you don't do this, you may hide a few. You may hide. You know, there were so many of them. Million. You might not miss 300 or 400. You might not miss 3,000. I don't know how many you can miss, not miss. But it wouldn't matter to Moses because he warned them. Who will know if no one else will know? God will know. And the thing is, if y'all, this small group, decides to do this, it's going to affect everybody. How will it affect them? Well, it's he said that you will wander in the wilderness till you die out. In other words, you will be locked away from the family of God's people till you die out. You won't have another chance to enter into the problem. Is it worth the risk? Remember that. I don't think sometimes people that are saved realize that they're trying to bargain with God. And they think that maybe if mom and daddy, preacher, Sunday school teacher, church, whoever don't see me, then there's no problem. Hey, it don't matter. It's some people, they'll apologize and they'll say an ugly word and they'll say, oh, preacher, I'm sorry. I'm going, hey, you know, I appreciate, you know, kind of not doing that around me, you know, because I don't do it. I said, but the one you need to be worried about is not me. I mean, I don't have virgin ears. I ain't even got a clean mouth. If I had a clean mouth, I'd probably never said anything or lied or anything else. But I'll tell you, I'm flesh and I have done those things. Worst of all, I thought more than I've said. Thank God I didn't say them, but I still had sinned. So I'd rather be immune to that kind of stuff and people respect and, you know, not respect me, but respect him. I'm going, hey, it ain't me you got to worry about. I could tell Reuben and Gad that same thing. Hey, Moses said, it ain't me you got to worry about. I'm not going to make it anyway because of some of my foolishness. But truly, your sins will find you out. I guess that would be the thing to say. Be careful of what you're doing, saying, and how you're acting. And are you acting in good faith? Are you walking by faith? Because it's not. The Bible says, surely your sins will find you out. And how will that happen? The Bible says that some of those things will be shouted from the mountaintop. How embarrassing. I'm glad. Have y'all seen the thing that China's got over there, that they got something going on that they can tell the temperature of a bunch of people walking through a building? And they got a little thing up, a little bubble pop. Y'all seen that, haven't you? If you ain't, you need to watch TV a little bit. Anyway, it's kind of just massive that they can tell if somebody's got. I reckon if you got 101 temperature, they're going to arrest you. I don't know. But they're watching you, and they can tell by just that one little thing if there's something going on. Let me tell you, God has had this done forever. He lives in our heart. He lives within the world. He knows. Don't make a vow that you can't keep. It's better not to make one. We all have done it. someone get in bad shape, you get in bad shape, something happened, Lord, if you would just, ooh. And then after things get better, you may go on the stray side again. And then what happens, surely your sins will find you out. Mama says this, and this ain't scripture, but if you lay down with the dogs, you're probably going to get fleas. My wife's a hairdresser. And one of the most embarrassing things to some folks is if they come into her shop and them or their kids has got head lice. I'm sure that's embarrassing. My kids has had hair lice. If you ain't never had hair lice, you probably got dirty hair because they like clean hair. Non-oily hair. But just as those lice can show up anywhere, and then you have to get something. Go to the grocery store. You buy this stuff called Red. Huh. Y'all ain't know you're shaking your head, but I know you had head lice probably. Brother Don ain't got it to worry about. He ain't got enough hair to hide new lice. But I don't know if I ever had them in my life either, but people's had them. And it ain't no sin that you had them. You've come in contact with somebody had. But the lice represents sin. If you hang around where that's at, it'll get on you. And the more you try to hide it, directly you have to go to the a pharmacist or somewhere like that, or a hairstylist that says, hey, this is what you got to do. This is what you got to do. And they're going, oh, please don't tell nobody. Surely your sins will find you out. You can keep them lies hid from a lot of people, but directly you're going to have to go buy you some Red. You try your little diesel fuel, you might lose all your hair. I don't know. But the neat thing about that, and I'm going to hush about that. My wife's going to kill me when I get home anyway. When you wash that head in Red, if that's all you do, then the battle's not over. You think, if I'll do this, you know, a lot of people say, well, I'll just confess my sins to God and that's going to fix it. Well, it will, as long as there's not a residue of something to come later. And with that Red, it'll kill the little bugs, but the problem is there's them little nits, it's called eggs. And if you don't go in there with that little tool and pull them out and get rid of the seed of sin, they'll come back. Is it worth doing all that to have to go through all that? Not when you can prevent it. But remember in all things, surely your sins will find you out. Father, tonight we thank you again. Your word is so great, so rich. But God, it is powerful. And God, you're not ignorant. I think sometimes people think you just don't see nothing, you're old or what. God, you're not, and we know that. You have an all-seeing eye. And you're watching us. God, I pray we would think on those things. Let's don't do the things that someone else done and it didn't turn out good for them. God, the Bible tells us that he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him is a sin. If we know we shouldn't do it, then just don't do it. Because our sins will find us out. God, I pray tonight we would understand that. And God, I'm not just speaking to this bunch as though they were not the choir. But God, it's food for my soul. It should be food for everyone's soul. Help us, Lord, to remember you are with us for our protection, our guidance, and our salvation. But you're also there and seeing all the wrong. Let us try to do better. We love you and we thank you for how you have blessed us. In Jesus' name.